हमारा जो पिछला रिकॉर्डिंग था प्रोफेसर जीडी अग्रवाल के बारे में, मुझे तो बहुत पसंद आया,
जी
और खास तौर पे इस बात पे मुझे बहुत अच्छा लगा कि जिस भाषा में आपने उनकी कहानी सुनाई वो बहुत ही अच्छी लगी मुझे, वो भाषा बहुत ही रिफ्रेशिंग लगी उस भाषा में किसी को बात करते हुए सुनकर। तो इस
प्रोफेसर
बात
जी
को
डी
ले,
अग्रवाल, वो तो प्रोफेसर जी डी अग्रवाल उसी भाषा में बात करते थे।
ये भी उसी भाषा में बात करते थे, आपने सही कहा। तो इस बात के लिए मैं आपको धन्यवाद करता हूँ, आपको साधुवाद करता हूँ। अब अपनी बात को आगे बढ़ाते हैं। आपने जो कहा उसमें से बहुत सारे मुद्दे निकल रहे हैं, कुछ कुछ काफी तो छोटे मोटे मुद्दे हैं लेकिन कुछ अहम मुद्दे हैं, तो मुझे लगता है उन पर हमको बात करनी चाहिए ठीक से।
जरूर।
कुछ मुद्दे मैंने लिस्ट किए हैं, वो मैं आपके साथ एक एक करके साझा करूंगा और देखते हैं ये रिकॉर्डिंग आगे किस कैसे जाती है। शुरुआत में इस बात से करता हूँ कि जो आपने प्रोफेसर अग्रवाल का जो पत्र था, जो उन्होंने पहले फास्ट के समय लिखा था भारत के लोगों को, जो कि हमारे मित्र आदरणीय राम के ब्लॉग पर उपलब्ध है, और उसका हमने डिस्क्रिप्शन भी दिया है पहली रिकॉर्डिंग में। अब ये इंटरेस्टिंग बात है कि उन्होंने जो साइन ऑफ किया है पत्र, वो लिखा है योर ओन कल्चरल कॉन्शियंस। ये इस तरह से साइन ऑफ करा हुआ पत्र मैंने जीवन में नहीं देखा आज तक। तो थोड़ा इस पे बात शुरू करते हैं कि ऐसा उन्होंने क्यों लिखा और इसका मतलब क्या है, इसके मायने क्या है।
आपने जो पूछा ये तो बहुत महत्वपूर्ण बात है, और बहुत सारे लोग जो पत्र मिलता है तो उसके गौर से नहीं पढ़ते हैं, और कई ऐसे लोग होते हैं जो अपने हर किसी शब्द को दो बार सोचकर ही लिखते हैं। तो हमारे यहाँ भारत में तो कहते हैं कि अगर कोई विद्वान है तो उसे ही विद्वान कहनी चाहिए जो अपने शब्दों को बहुत ही सोच समझकर इस्तेमाल करता हो, और अगर विद्वान हो तो उसने जो भी शब्द की प्रयोग किया है तो आप कह नहीं सकते कि एक शब्द को निकाल सके और दूसरी शब्द को वहां पर डाल सके। जैसे कवि सम्राट विश्वनाथ सत्यनारायण जी एक बार कहते हैं, देखो वाल्मीकि रामायण में जो श्लोक है, हर एक शब्द की पर्यायवाची शब्द तो मिल जाएगी, और अगर वो अनुष्टुप छंद में आपको वहां पर लगाने की या लगाने से कोई छंदो दोष ना हो तो भी आप उसी शब्द की प्रयोग करनी चाहिए, क्योंकि नहीं तो वहां पर उस भाषा और उस भाव की जो संपूर्ण क्षेत्र जो है उसको हम समझ नहीं पाते। नो वर्ड इज रिप्लेसेबल। इन अ सेंस से वन कुड सर्टनली स्ट्राइव टू बी सच अ काइंड ऑफ अ पर्सन हु मेक्स अ कॉन्शियस डिसीशन टू यूज वर्ड्स केयरफुली, एंड प्रोफेसर जी डी अग्रवाल वॉज वन सच पर्सन हु taught that to his students and taught it even by practice. One thing that I'd certainly want you to ask me later is his interview to Down to Earth, where he actually refers to the term rejuvenation. This was in his sixth fast, few days before he actually gave up his body. He mentions that, say, the then Modi government started a ministry for Ganga rejuvenation. So rejuvenation का शब्द का प्रयोग किया है, तो rejuvenation क्या होती है, and he goes on to give further detail on that. So he was somebody who was very strict about the kind of words that he used, so which is why we have a great degree of matter to talk about, because each word is weighed and each word has a story behind it. So I was fortunate to ask why he used certain words and why not some other words. So I'll tell about those also in the due course of our discussion.
Yes, yes.
But let us begin with, say, this 2008 letter. Notice that it was written from Pramodwan Chitrakoot. It does not have the name of the person written. It says dear dot dot dot.
Yes.
And it refers to Hindus. It also refers to what does it mean to actually be somebody who has bhakti, faith in religion, if one is not ready to give up one's life on what we strongly have faith in. So there's a context that he builds, and then he signs up by saying your own cultural conscience. You see, the term cultural conscience is something that is a heavy term. One reason is that today we find it hard to find people with cultural conscience. And even those people who have that cultural conscience, they do not know in what manner can they actually bring to their actions whatever that cultural conscience says. We need to understand the kind of, say, post-independent life that we have come to, where even to speak of certain kind of thought process is something that is found to be out of place.
Yes.
So 1931, you remember that, say, there was this famous lecture by Professor K.C. Bhattacharya, Swaraj in Ideas.
Yes.
Or yahan par to स्वामी सानंद स्वराज इन प्रैक्टिस के बारे में बात कर रहे हैं। जब हमें हमारे पास स्वराज इन आइडियाज ही नहीं हो तो प्रैक्टिस के बाद में सोच सकते हैं। बट एटलीस्ट से हिज आइडिया ऑफ टॉकिंग ऑफ कल्चरल कॉन्शियस आल्सो इज समथिंग दैट नीड्स टू बी सीन इन द लाइट ऑफ हिज रिपीटेड रेफरेंस टू कंसिडरिंग हिमसेल्फ एज वन ऑफ द डिसेंडेंट्स ऑफ भगीरथा, Rama, and so on. And considering himself as such a descendant, in a sense, I do not know whether, say, this was a conscious thought or not, but certainly, say, the reference that he has, see, Agrawals are stated to be those who have come from a Kshatriya king by name Agrasen Maharaj. There is a legend of Agrasen Maharaj. Now, here is an instance where somebody who considers Ganga as an inheritance, Ganga ji hamari dharohar hai, aur main chahta hu ki Bharat ke sabhi log ise apne dharohar ke tarah bachaye. This was a kind of message that Professor G.D. Agarwal and then Swami Sanand try to as well instill and convey to people. And you see, here is a person who is fasting unto death on one of those kind of symbols of the Bharatiya Sanatanata, that if one is not actually finding itself to see that this is something that requires attention, then we are actually only to say that, yes, this is Kali Yuga. And Professor G.D. Agarwal was very conscious of that, which is why he mentions that at a time when many people are fascinated with hydroelectric power, that letter actually details, he mentions that, say, those who are enamored with the nature of development that we have, in what manner can I actually do anything? So the only thing that I can do is to think of a tapasya. And tapasya in such a manner where even if he were to give up his life in that process, it's worth it. Mm. Tapasya, as I mentioned in our previous discussion, is actually meant to gain strength. And the reference there also is something that we spoke of in terms of the three-generation tapasya that we found for Ganga Avatarana in the country. Mm. So Bhagiratha's tapasya itself is what is very popular, but for that to happen also, there are two more generations prior to that, which also say did a tapasya because they wanted to ensure that their parloka, for their entire vamsha, is something that is secured. So the cultural conscience part actually makes us think of the entire role that you find Gangaji plays in our life. Mm. And whether or not people find it, these days we have many deaths happening in hospitals. But if you look at, say, the way in which our traditional embrace of death used to happen in our own homes, you used to have people who were laid down on the floor with, say, a darbhashayana, on which, say, people lie down and waited till the death came. And at that moment, people who were attending, they used to give a sip of Gangajal.
Yes.
Just before you die. Which is why, say, the shloka that I referred to in the beginning of our discussion on the Ganga Ashtakam of Adishankara, it ends by pointing to Sanandam Smarato Bhavishyati Mama Prana Prayanotsave. That is, I'd be very happily thinking of you during my own journey from this body to another, or from this body to a higher world. So that was the reference there. So Mama Prana Prayanotsave, say when the prana is actually being, is leaving the body. So when cultural conscience is referred to, where exactly can we find the kind of response from common people, or from, say, the people who are in positions of power, when they can clearly see that here is that great Ganga, of which you find several references made by great scholars. One scholar that I can right away refer to is Vachaspati Mishra, who is also known as Shaddarsana Tikakara, because he wrote a tika for all the six darshanas, Astika darshanas. He also wrote a commentary on Adi Shankara's Brahma Sutra Bhashya, and which is famous as Bhamati Chatusutri. Bhamati was the name of his wife. Mm. And in that, in the beginning itself, he tries to convey what is the effort that he is doing. And he makes a upamana. There's an analogy there. And the analogy goes something like this. Rathyodakamiva Ganga Pravaha Pataha Pavitrayati. Rathyodakam is, say, a channel. You could say it's some kind of a nala, which when actually it meets the Ganga Pravahapata. See, the word is Pravahapata because Ganga is actually falling from the highest place. Akasha Ganga is now falling onto Lord Shiva's the matted hairs. And from there, it is actually, say, coming down to Himalaya, which is the tallest range that you know. And from that heights, she's actually falling, and falling with, say, full of energy. And with that flow, when she is actually flowing, anything that actually joins would actually get purified, because the quality of Ganga itself is to purify. The cultural conscience of India recalls Ganga as not any other water. It recalls as that which is mokshadayini, papa vimochani. So these are the kind of reference that are there. So now this pravaha pata is missing. And what was Vachaspati Mishra saying? He's saying that my effort to write this commentary, his commentary is regarded as one of the best commentaries that you would find to Adi Shankara's Brahma Sutra Bhashya. And in Bhamati, he says, my effort is like that small channel which is mixing into the great flow of Ganga. And what is that great flow of Ganga? It is Adi Shankara's Brahma Sutra Bhashya. And I am getting purified by this effort of mine. So that was the metaphor, the analogy used in Bhamati. And what it conveys to us is, and you see, this is something that was in the 10th century or so. 5 centuries later, a similar metaphor is also used in another equally important write-up on Madhvacharya's commentary on the Brahma Sutra Bhashya by, if I'm not wrong, Jayatirtha. So you see that this kind of thought is a flowing thought, and any talk of Ganga cannot happen without that kind of a flow that is talked of. And there are places where, of course, you do find that, say, there's a beautiful description that you find in Valmiki Ramayana as to how was Ganga flowing. So at times, say, it was very fast. At other places, it is slow. And it actually gives you a very serene atmosphere in which it was actually going about its task of purifying the worlds. So such is the kind of cultural conscience, cultural memory that one has to as well say, get the moment one thinks of Ganga. And that Ganga today, you find is no longer a perennial river. In our childhood, our geography textbooks used to distinguish what is rain-fed rivers and perennial rivers. So rain-fed rivers could as well say dry up when it is not the rainy season. But perennial rivers are those which you would find the flow to be present throughout the year. I mean, in the country, it is very hard to find any river that can be claimed to be perennial today.
Yeah.
You just look at any river that is there, because where is the water? It's all stored up in the dams, in these reservoirs behind the dams, or it is basically channeled into some canal and taken away.
Yeah, so it's stolen. It's stolen through tankers and water bottling plants.
Water bottling mostly happens with the underground water. To my knowledge, not the river water though. But these days, of course, yes, you are right. You are right that, say, even IRCTC has started a project of selling Ganga water to people across the world. You see, hamari aastha aisi hai ki hum yahan par baithkar IRCTC ko pooch sakte hain. Aap bhej dijiye hame aur India Post mein aa jayegi. Ganga jal ki ek bottle, plastic bottle.
Plastic bottle.
So our cultural memory and cultural conscience have come down to this stage where, see, it's not that you can't actually get this waters from elsewhere to here. See, even in earlier times, you had, say, rajas who actually made special arrangements so that for Abhisheka, for Sivalinga, whether it is in Somnath or other such Jyotirlinga Kshetras, there was a supply of Ganga waters coming from Triveni, Sangama, and so on. So this is not something that is a new exercise, but the thought that goes behind it about how do you as well try to go about doing it, whether it aligns with, say, what is the sense of what are this great heritage that we carry, whether it is in line with it or not. This thought is something that is normally non-occurrent. And it is in that light that I strongly believe that, say, the effort of Swami Gyan Swarup Sanand and Professor G.D. Agarwal's this fasting exercise was to see if that cultural conscience could be awakened. Yeah, our friend Srinivasa made a very important point, during this sixth fast of Swami Sanand, and also when he gave up his mortal body. And that was what happened to the Sakshi Prajna of the Bharatiyas.
Mm-hmm.
He used the word Sakshi Prajna. See, we are witness to what's happening around. And here is something where you have a person who was hale and healthy, who need not have actually undertaken this fast, who could as well have, say, relished whatever his achievements were, and you are aware that say those achievements aren't in no small measure, but the effort was to try and see that we aren't yet where we ought to be. And in fact, in 2008 itself, he said, it appears to me that my entire lifetime efforts that I have undertaken, they seem to be in such a way that they are all pointing me in this direction, that I have to dedicate myself to my mother Gangaji's protection, conservation. And in that process, even if I give up my life, that is something which is actually only going to strengthen the possibilities of this sequence of trying to make efforts to protect and conserve Gangaji. So that was the kind of bhavana which Professor G.D. Agarwal very strongly carried. I don't know if I can as well put it across in the same manner, where if you listen to him say, "Mera jeena bahut durbhar ban gaya hai." He used more or less these words in his first letter to Prime Minister Modi, calling him, of course, the mere chote bhai Narendra Modi, and that I cannot continue living conscious of the kind of atrocities committed to my mother. Can I actually be a good son? This is a conscious kind of pricking question that comes back to me. And with such a kind of question in mind, can I at all live in peace? That I do not see. So this was the kind of bhavana. And you see, normally, to actually find a sense of empathy or to be sensitive towards the pain of the other is not an easy thing. The very first expression of poetry that you find in Sanskrit was actually an expression of that Karuna Rasa. The shloka of Valmiki, Ma Nishada, is actually asking the hunter to stop once he has actually hit the one of the crowns of Pakshi. So that Karuna is something that is not because Valmiki felt that pain to himself, but he could empathize with the pain of that other bird which was crying for her lost partner. Now, there won't be many people that you would find who feel a great sense of pain when they see a river which is dried up. And even if somebody is, say, pained by it, you may not find many people who would think that, say, it is an obligation on me that I need to see this river flowing again. And in modern times, because all this drying up of rivers in the cities or major areas has got to do with a great degree of civil engineering marvels, modern day marvels built by human beings. So here was Professor G.D. Agarwal, who was trained in that. So he knew what was going on there. He knew the technical know-how. He had the technical know-how of what it was. And he also has this great sense of cultural connect. And this is not happening to any other river. It's happening to Gangaji. This is where, say, the reference to cultural conscience, it has to actually bring up all this and more to our conscious memory. The moment you see that, what is it that our cultural conscience had to say when someone is fasting for Gangaji? This is what he intended, but only those who already have it probably actually say looked at it. and many those who actually got to learn of it a little later, they would say, yeah, he's saying right. But then you see, we are like this, world is like this. So what do you do? Kya kar sakte hain? So that's the kind of state of affairs that we are still in. And possibly say, shaking that up is not an easy task also.
ये आपने बहुत अच्छी बात कही है और बहुत अहम बात है कि आज के ज़माने में जो एक बड़ी समस्या है ख़ासतौर पे हम भारतवासियों की, वो है लॉस ऑफ कल्चरल कॉन्शियंस और उसी से जुड़ा हुआ है लॉस ऑफ कल्चरल मेमोरी। हमारी जो स्मृति है वो भी बहुत संकुचित हो गई है और हमारा जो चिंतन है, हमारी जो चिंताएं हैं, वो भी बहुत संकुचित हो गए हैं, वो एक पैराडाइम में ही सीमित रह गए हैं। और इस बात पे ध्यान दिलाना मेरे ख्याल से बहुत महत्वपूर्ण है कि कल्चरल कॉन्शियंस जैसी कोई चीज़ है हम भारतवासियों की, और उसका
होनी चाहिए जरूर,
और होनी चाहिए और उसका पुनर्जागरण होना चाहिए। मेरे विचार में एक बहुत बड़ा जो लॉस हुआ है पिछले 100-150 सालों में, जिस पे कोई बहुत ज़्यादा बात नहीं हुई है, वो है भिक्षावृत्ति समाज का समाप्त हो जाना। जैसे आप जानते हैं, भिक्षावृत्ति समाज वो समाज है, समाज का एक बड़ा हिस्सा है, जिन्होंने दिन प्रतिदिन लोगों में कहानियाँ, कथाएँ, इतिहास सुनाए हैं और भारतीय शैली में, भारतीय भाषाओं में सुनाए हैं। इस समाज के ह्रास से मैं देखता हूँ ये कल्चरल कॉन्शियसनेस का ह्रास जुड़ा हुआ है। और आधुनिक भारत में जो कहानियाँ व्याप्त हैं, प्रचलित हैं, वो कहानियाँ, वो कथाएँ और कल्चरल कॉन्शियस का कोई लेना देना है नहीं, या वो एक बिल्कुल ही अलग,
हम अभी नए दौर में लिख रहे हैं
मिलकर नई कहानी। हाँ, वो दिलीप कुमार का गाना था, छोड़ो कल की बातें, कल की बात पुरानी, नए दौर में लिखेंगे मिलके नई कहानी। तो नई कहानियों में भारतवर्ष या आधुनिक हिंदुस्तान फंस गया है।
पुरानी कह रहे हैं, पर बहुत सारे लोग ऐसे कहते हैं कि
आजाद हो गया है।
अच्छा हुआ हम उसे पीछे छोड़ के आगे हैं।
लेकिन मुझे और मेरे जैसे आप हैं, हमारे मित्रों को तो शायद ये लगता है कि पुरानी कथाओं में, पुरानी कहानियों में, पुरानी बोलने की जो शैली है उसमें कुछ दम था। इसी बात से जुड़कर ये अगला
है भी।
हाँ, इसी बात से जुड़कर अब अगली बात पे आते हैं जहाँ हमारी पिछली रिकॉर्डिंग समाप्त हुई थी। ये कहानी है प्रोफेसर जीडी अग्रवाल की, जो टेहरी डैम जब बन रहा था और उसके उस वो बने ना बने उस पर मंथन चल रहा था, उस मंथन में प्रोफेसर जीडी अग्रवाल भी शामिल थे। और जैसा आपने बताया कि वो विश्व हिंदू परिषद की तरफ से वहाँ पे बैठे थे और उसमें वो ये कहते हैं कि भाई ये गंगा जो है ये सिर्फ नदी नहीं है, ये एक बाकी नदियों जैसी नदी नहीं है और गंगा को धरती पर मानव की प्यास बुझाने के लिए नहीं लाया गया है, इसका दूसरा प्रयोजन है
जी।
तो उस कहानी पे आते हैं, वो कहानी उस टाइम आपने छेड़ी थी, मैंने आपको रोक दिया था। उस कहानी पे आते हैं कि वो टेहरी डैम की जो मीटिंग थी वो क्या थी, और उसमें प्रोफेसर जीडी अग्रवाल उसमें किस बात पर हमारा ध्यान दिलाना चाह रहे थे, इस पर थोड़ा बताइए।
जी, ये बात हमें पहचानी चाहिए कि टेहरी डैम की जो पहली प्रपोजल थी वो तो लेट 1970s में आई थी और उत्तराखंड में आप श्री सुंदरलाल बहुगुणा जी को जानते होंगे, तो
जी।
जो उनके चिपको मूवमेंट थी और उन्होंने और उनके साथियों ने बहुत कोशिश की ताकि ये टेहरी डैम की जो भी चिंतन हो रही थी उसको रुकवाने के लिए। तो आप देख सकते हैं कि लेट 1970s से लेकर के 2002 तक तकरीबन 20 साल से ज़्यादा अगर कह सकते हैं कि ये जो मॉडर्न डेवलपमेंट की जो स्ट्रेंथ और फोर्स है उसको रोक पाना हुआ, तो ये भी कोई मामूली सी बात नहीं है।
हाँ, बड़ी बात है।
और आप अगर ध्यान से देखें तो प्रोफेसर जी डी अग्रवाल की जो जो सोच थी वो ये डैम की जो रुकवाने के लिए जिस तरह की आर्ग्यूमेंट्स दिए गए हैं उस तरह के आर्ग्यूमेंट उन्होंने नहीं बनाया। तो आप तो नर्मदा बचाओ आंदोलन जानते हैं।
जी जी।
और वहाँ पर जो चर्चा हुई है वो विस्थापन के कारण जिस तरह की कष्ट बहुत सारे आम जनता और जो कि पिछड़े वर्ग के लोग जो होते हैं तो उनको भुगतना पड़ता है इसकी जो भी कॉन्सिक्वेंसेस हो। सो द एंटायर आर्ग्यूमेंट दैट वाज एक्चुअली मेड अगेंस्ट द कंस्ट्रक्शन ऑफ लार्ज डैम्स टर्न्ड आउट टू बी इन टर्म्स ऑफ व्हाट हैपेंस बिकॉज ऑफ डिस्प्लेसमेंट एंड द काइंड ऑफ लॉसेस दैट वुड रिजल्ट इन टू द ecology which got added a little later, but none of this carried the sense of the religious ethos that could also be say a very valid and strong argument that can be put forth, and this was not actually brought to the fore prior to say Professor G.D. Agarwal's conscious bringing that into the focus. So his reference to religious faith, specifically that of Hindu religious faith, is a very important aspect because he didn't just do it as a matter of a strategy. He also pointed out that one must notice that during the British rule, when the British wanted to continue the earlier act of building barrages on the river Ganga, there was a great resistance which was erected under the leadership of Pandit Madan Mohan Malviyaji along with the then rajas of Banaras and the princely states which were surrounding Haridwar and the locations which are by the Ganga river. I do not recall exactly the list of all those rulers of princely states who are all also party to this. Pandit Madanmohan Malviyaji was the leader and they struck a deal with the British government that there shall not be any kind of an obstruction to the flow of Ganga. So even if there is a dam that is constructed, the dam shall have a gate. See, dams have these gates through which gates are closed and gates are opened. So there will be at least one gate which will always be open. It won't have any, say, it won't get locked up anytime. So, which means that, say, there is one dhara of water. So, if you happen to go to Haridwar, you can still get to see that dhara. Whereas the other gates which are there, they open up and they get closed. But here is one thing, and they call it as Ram Dhara.
Okay.
So, they ensured with the help of a deal that there shall be a continuous flow which will be there, and there are say certain conditions also on what can be done and what not in that kind of dealing. And you would find that Professor G.D. Agarwal point out that Sundarlal Bahugunaji or the other leaders who were actually trying to oppose Tehri Dam, they never used this agreement of the Indian princely state rulers under the leadership of Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya with the British government on, say, what should be the policy on Ganga, on the flows of Ganga. So he pointed this out and then said that possibly, if at all this was brought to attention much earlier, maybe we could have, say, had a different kind of a turn to this entire way in which things unfolded. So this is post-facto recognition, but certainly a very strong point. And in 2002, see, the argument can be very simple now. You see, the British were actually people who still who recognized the cultural conscience of Indians. And here we are, post-independent India. There's nothing like a cultural conscience anymore that is left. And that too, to have, say, post 91, 92, when there is this force of quote-unquote Hindutva, which was actually becoming a rising force in the Indian political scene, it could not possibly be an easy issue if at all, say, this kind of a thought was brought in. Such was the kind of thinking that Professor G.D. Agarwal brought to the fore into the discussion. Now, Professor G.D. Agarwal was probably the first scientist in India to look at what are the special properties of the waters of Ganga.
Yes.
So Ganga Jal ka kya mahatv hai? Agar kuch mahatv ho, to kya hume aajkal ki jo ki vaikyanik tarikhe hain, to us tarikhon se hum kya kya kis tarah ke results pa sakte hain? This was a question that was very important to him. And at IIT Kanpur, when many professors possibly were working on such kind of questions, which probably did not have a kind of connect with, say, the India's cultural heritage, Professor G.D. Agarwal often used to remember this point in Ganga Stotra of attributed to Adi Shankara that says something like this: Rogam, Shokam, Tapam, Papam, Harame, Bhagavati, Kumati, Kalapam. What was the kind of powers that Ganga's waters carried? Rogam, Shokam, Tapam, Papam, Kumati, Kalapam, Bhagavati, Hara. So, Bhagavati, Ganga, please remove all these. So the last one is most interesting, Kumati Kalapam.
Yeah, all these means rogam, diseases.
Rogam is disease. Shokam is shokam. Rogam is disease, illness. Shokam is sorrows. Tapam, see, tapa again are of three kinds: adhibhautika, adhidaivika, and adhyatmika tapa. So when you find this Shanti mantra that says Shanti, 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 the three Shantis are meant for shamana of adhibhautika tapa, adhidaivika tapa, and adhyatmika tapa.
Yeah, so tapa, so primarily means heat or temperature. So remove the temperature in the three realms of my life.
Three realms, yes.
Yes.
And then rogam, shokam, tapam, papam.
Papam.
Papam. Then, harame bhagavati kumati kalapam. So, kumati kalapam also, that is, if at all there are people who are having, say, kumati and their actions because of their sick mind.
Kumati. Oh, sumati is, oh, and kumati. Okay.
Kumati kalapam.
Sumati is a good mind and kumati is the sick mind.
Yes. So, sick mind, whatever its kalapa, whatever its actions are, whatever its consequences are, so if you can as well cure the Kumati and make it a Sumati. So if you take a dip in Ganga, even if a Kumati becomes Sumati, then what kind of a world we live in?
Yes.
Just imagine. So this is a belief, but and there are many people who still believe in this. But the key point is, one cannot possibly say Shokam and it's going away by taking in a dip in Ganga is a measurable thing because it is an intangible thing. So is the case with Tapam. So is the case with Papam. And Kumati Kalapam also, these are all not measurable things. And Professor G.D. Agarwal is a civil engineer who was very fond of chemistry. And chemistry people are actually always very fond of different kinds of measures and measurements and trying to see what are the kind of values that you can get and so on. So Rogam is one point that you can measure. That is, if at all somebody has a disease, can it be cured by the waters of Ganga? That's a question which can actually be posed. And you see, when people say there is this notion of Vaidyo Narayano Harihi, that is, Vaidya needs to be treated as Narayana, is one formulation. In that same shloka, Aushadam Jahnami Toyam, Vaidyo Narayano Harihi, is the shloka's pada. So, Aushadam Jahnavi Toyam, whether it should be taken literally or is it a metaphor, like when you are actually say, in your last moments of your life, the Aushadha to be taken is Jahnavi Toyam and the Vaidya is Lord Narayana, is one reading of it. But the point of Aushadam Jahnavi Toyam is an important point which is there in the cultural memory. And Swami Gyanaswarup Sanand told, in fact, he also wrote about it, that in his childhood, he saw certain Ayurveda Vaidya say that you would eat these things, do not eat these things, and drink only Ganga waters. That will fix your disease. So he heard this. So he has that memory. And as a young child, he was somebody who walked along River Ganga several times. So he knows what it used to be before Tehri, before Maneri Bhali, these hydroelectric power projects and so on. And many of us do not have that memory. You see, if we and you and I also had that memory, maybe say you could possibly compare the two, but we don't have that opportunity to as well say, recall that such was the flow in Ganga. So he wanted to see if I can devise an experiment to try and establish that there is some property in Ganga which can ensure that diseases are cured. So the first experiment that he did was he chose to take Ganga water samples from specifically those areas which are known to the Indians as Tirtha Kshetras. Mm-hmm. Varanasi, Prayaga, today is Prayagraj, right? So Prayagraj. Then you have along this, the flow of Ganga, several say, there's a place called Shukratal.
Yes, yes, very close to my village.
Yeah, so you have variety of these are all kshetras, Tirtha Kshetras, and he picked up Ganga water samples from there and also picked up waters from in between, say, two kshetras. Okay? And having taken all these samples back to the laboratory, he added a lot of sewage water into it. Now, sewage water contains what is known as E. coli bacteria. So, he measured that, say, in the sewage water that he is mixing, The E. coli bacteria is in some millions of numbers. And having mixed that into Ganga water taken from these, specifically the Tirtha Kshetras, he mixed that and then left that water sample like that for a couple of days. And again, tried to see what is the percentage of those E. coli bacteria that are still remaining. And he noticed that almost 99% of these E. coli bacteria got killed. So that means, say there is a colicidal, bactericidal property which is present in these waters. And in between those two places where, say, I said, between Prayaga and let's say Varanasi, in some place outside of it also some sample was taken. And in that also, he noticed that there was certainly an ability to kill the bacteria, but it was not to that extent as it can be found in this instance. So he also tried to connect this up and said that our ancestors recognized that there is something special about the waters in these places, which they, which Puranas actually tell you the legends of those places. And if you take a dip in those areas, then these people who take a dip there, you would find that those people who take a dip in there possibly knew in the past that the waters there are going to add something more to you than otherwise. So this is one bactericidal property that he got his student to show, and he, that was probably one of the first master's thesis on it. And you have several such other scholars who have continued in that line. And the, then the question was, what caused this kind of a...
हाँ, इसपे एक चीज मैं ऐड करना चाहता हूँ, ये हाइपोथेसिस ही समझिए इस चीज को. जैसे हमारे यहाँ जो वन है, जो फॉरेस्ट है, वो सिर्फ नेचुरल फॉरेस्ट ही नहीं माने गए हैं, लेकिन मैन मेड फॉरेस्ट भी माने गए हैं. जैसे बहुत सारी जो 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 वाटर बॉडीज हैं वो केवल नेचुरल वाटर बॉडीज नहीं है, वो मैन मेड वाटर बॉडीज भी हैं. तो ये मैन मेड वाटर फॉरेस्ट में एक फॉरेस्ट होता है औषधि वन, जो मेडिसिनल प्लांट्स के लिए लगाया गया वन है.
Yes.
अच्छा, उसमें ये एक मान्यता है, इसको किसी को स्टडी ठीक से करना चाहिए या कैसे पता करेंगे, कि जो हिमालय का जो ऊपर का क्षेत्र है जहाँ से रिवर ओरिजिनेट्स हो रही हैं, ये सब लगाए हुए प्लांटेड मेडिसिनल फॉरेस्ट्स हैं. और मेरे विचार में इसका एक सबसे उत्तम उदाहरण है ये वैली ऑफ फ्लावर्स बद्रीनाथ के पास. इसको फूलों की घाटी कहते हैं. पूरी की पूरी वैली मेडिसिनल फ्लावर्स से भरी हुई है. और मेरा ये मानना है कि ये नेचुरल नहीं है, ये मतलब एक क्यूरेटेड वैली रही है, जो कि अब तो ऑफ कोर्स नहीं होता है, तो नेचुरली है. लेकिन मुझे लगता है कि गंगा के पानी, गंगा जल के जो औषधि प्रवृत्ति है, उसका एक बहुत बड़ा कारण यह है कि जिन जंगलों से वो निकल के आ रही है, वो क्यूरेटेड मेडिसिनल फॉरेस्ट्स रहे हैं परंपरागत, जिससे ये चीज, ये इसके पानी में ये गुण आया है. और इस बात को कैसे देखा जाए, देखना चाहिए, एक हाइपोथेसिस ही है अभी तो इसको.
नो, दिस इज समथिंग दैट यू आर एक्चुअली से रिकॉलिंग व्हाट वाज द फर्स्ट एक्सप्लेनेशन दैट प्रोफेसर जी डी अग्रवाल गेव टू द रीजन व्हाई सच काइंड ऑफ प्रॉपर्टीज आर टू बी फाउंड इन द वाटर्स ऑफ गंगा. एंड एज यू मेंशनड, गंगा इज नॉट अ नेचुरल वाटर बॉडी. इट्स समथिंग व्हिच इवन एज द लेजेंड सेज was brought with human effort. That's, say, a second point. And in fact, I still remember, say, there was one instance where Professor G.D. Agarwal was told that if you are to think of, say, what ought to be the kind of lateral connectivity, there are these three types of connectivities that Professor G.D. Agarwal used to speak of. It is for something to be called aviral, you should not have any kind of restrictions. And these restrictions are longitudinal. So if you build a dam across the river, then the longitudinal connectivity will get cut off.
Yes.
And the lateral connectivity is if you are going to have a concrete river banks that you build, then that again is one kind of a point. And the third thing is the depth which is there. So that is the riverbed.
The riverbed and also the openness. Open
and the openness. So the open to air and this. So that is the vertical connectivity.
Yes.
So all these three connectivities are to be maintained throughout the length and breadth of River Ganga is the kind of formulation and the definition of Aviralta that Swami Sanand spoke of. So this is what we tried to capture in that song. Tute nahi na lamba ime, tute nahi na uncha ime, tute nahi na chauda ime, aviral kiye chahi maine, hum bhi jane, aap bhi jane. So the point here is that the lateral connectivity part is a very interesting thing because in earlier times also, in the very ancient times, you had these ghats which were built.
Mm.
And the ghats were concrete. So when the ghats are concrete, then say, in what manner can you say the lateral connectivity can still be maintained? So if I remember it right, this was a discussion between Dwarka Shankaracharya ji, Jagatguru Shankaracharya, Swami Swarupananda Saraswati ji, and Swami Gyanaswarup Sanand. If I remember it right, this was a kind of a thing. And then the suggestion was, in Rajgriha, in Magatha, Rajgriha was the original Rajdhani of Magathan Empire. Later it moved to Pataliputra. So when Bhagiratha was actually say traveling by his chariot, Gangaji was actually traveling between these two the Ratha's wheels. So between the two wheels, and see, he was a samrat. So samrat's chariot, how big it will be. So that's an imagination. Mm-hmm. And then in between that was Ganga flowing. And it turned out that say in Rajgriha, one of this wheels actually got off, and then say some water actually seemed to have spread across. So you can still find such kind of measure there is what he heard from Swami Swarupananda Saraswati ji. And then if I remember it right again, say Swami Sanand went there, actually measured that up, and then said that you should ensure that at least say so many kind of meters of flow should always be there if at all a kind of concrete lateral construction were to come about. But the best kind of a thing would be if you have a mud bed as the bank which is made of natural rocks but not cement construction and so on. So the formulation that the Oshadhi Vana in the Himalayas could possibly be the reason why you find this medicinal properties in Gangajal was one of the first formulations. But then the other point was also that, how do you define a river? River is not something which is just about the flow of the waters. It's also the flow of whatever are the deposits. One of the reasons why you have Ganga's plains to be the most fertile in the world is because of the alluvial soil that they bring in from the mountain heights, the Himalayan heights. And finest of the sand actually gets, say, deposited. Finest of soil. And that way, even to this day, it is one of the most fertile regions and people actually wonder the number of lakhs of people that stretch of land has been feeding for thousands of years now. And if I remember it right, there was one very fascinating book also that came about called Ganga Water Machine, which tried to study the kind of very great way in which the water utilization is effectively done in this Ganga plains. So the point that Professor G.D. Agarwal recognized is that he said there seems to be some very special kind of deposits which are present in these regions. Because you see, water from one region had greater ability to kill the bacteria to a greater extent than the other places. I told you that, say, sample from Nautha Tirthakshetra was also taken. Though it had, say, some amount, it was not as great as the place where this Tirthakshetra was. So, he said that it is those places where the best deposit happened over time, and our ancestors knew that those were the places where these are there, and correspondingly stories are probably also told that taking a dip here is good and not taking a dip at some other place is advisable and things of the kind. So this is a kind of neat way in which he tried to posit a manner in which one could deal with this question of, on one side, the cultural memory that speaks of what is the special quality of Ganga, and then he recognized this. Now, when the Tehri Dam question came up, when he was actually made to represent Vishwa Hindu Parishad in this expert committee, which was then headed by the then Minister for Human Resource Development, Sri Murali Manohar Joshi ji, Swami Professor G.D. Agarwal made a very strong argument, saying that you see, we are going to do something which has never been done in the past ever. So, if we are to stop the flow of Gangaji, then I have already shown through my earlier researches that there is something special about the Gangajal, and I call that special property as Gangatva. So the Gangatva of Gangajal is actually in its ability, like Adi Shankara says, Rogam, Shokam, Papam, Papam, Harame Bhagavati, Kumati Kalapam. So that is the best expression of what is the Gangatva. So this best expression of Gangatva is something that cannot be lost, because that's a kind of inheritance that we have received from our ancestors since Bhagiratha. So that's a kind of inheritance that one should not ever lose out for some petty things like hydroelectric power now, or say for some kind of irrigation. Already it's a very well irrigated area, or to divert water to New Delhi. So these are not the kind of thoughts on which you think of trying to obstruct a river like Gangaji, because her purpose to come to earth was to actually give moksha to those 60,000 sons of Sagara who were cursed by Kapila and they turned to ashes. So when Ganga flows through those ashes, that was what Kapila said. When Ganga flows through them, then they'll attain Urdhvalokas. Till then, say it won't happen. So Bhagiratha was actually trying to ensure that his ancestors found their due place in Parloka, because they can't actually have any samskara without the bringing of Ganga onto earth. So that was the kind of effort that our ancestors did. And one cannot actually forget all this for, say, the temporal interests that we have, which are for the here and now. This was the first argument. And then he went on to say that if at all we are decided that we are going ahead with this, I want one rider that needs to be kept in mind. If you give me sufficient amount of funds, if I'm not wrong, he asked for around 8,000 crores or something. 8,000 crores of funding to do what? He said, I want to concretely show that or verify whether, say, obstructing the flow of the waters, whether it shall result in loss of the Gangatva, or whether it would be retained. If at all we can show scientifically that it is not going to be affected, then I have no issues for you to go ahead and build the Tehri Dam. But if in case there is indeed going to be a point that the special properties of Ganga are going to suffer because of the construction of the dam, then it is our bounden duty that we do not take this up further. So this was the argument made, but then 8,000 crores is not a small amount, A. And then you had, if I don't recall the people involved, but certainly I know that there was a senior bureaucrat who was a chief engineer who basically said, how can this kind of an argument be at all discussed in such a kind of a meeting?
हाँ, उस पे आते हैं. मेरे ख्याल से ये बहुत important point है. जहाँ तक अभी तक मैं समझा हूँ आपकी बात, प्रोफेसर जी डी अग्रवाल जो हमारी लौकिक या जो हमारी यूटिलिटेरियन चिंताएं हैं, इरिगेशन, बिजली का प्रोडक्शन, इन चिंताओं को
ड्रिंकिंग वाटर फॉर अर्बनाइज्ड एरियाज,
अर्बनाइज्ड एरियाज में ड्रिंकिंग वाटर की समस्या को सुलझाना, तो इन यूटिलिटेरियन लौकिक चिंताओं को वो थोड़ा नीचे बिठा रहे हैं. और जो हमारी सिविलाइजेशनल चिंता है, पवित्रता, पाप से मुक्ति और हमारी सुमति, हमारा मन का निश्चल होना, और जो हमारा जो आस्था है सिविलाइजेशनल स्तंभों पर, उस चिंता को ऊपर उठा रहे हैं. और जैसे कि आपने कहा कि किसी सज्जन ने
आस्था को बनाए रखना,
हाँ, और जैसे आपने कहा कि किसी सज्जन ने मीटिंग में कहा कि हम इस तरह की बात इस तरह की मीटिंग में कैसे कर सकते हैं.
अब I mean, I'm paraphrasing it, but more or less that's what happened.
अब क्योंकि आप खुद भारत के संविधान के भी एक तरह से स्टूडेंट रहे हैं, आपने संविधान को पढ़ा है, और भारत का संविधान
अभी भी है
और भारत का संविधान पॉपुलर मेमोरी में एक सेक्युलर वैल्यू को बढ़ाने वाला संविधान है, जिसका एक तात्पर्य यह है कि जो फेथ है वो प्राइवेट मैटर है, आस्था जो है वो आपके घर का मामला है. अब यहाँ पे प्रोफेसर जी डी अग्रवाल आस्था को पब्लिक फोरम पे स्थापित करना चाह रहे हैं, अटेम्प्ट कर रहे हैं.
और एक बात जरूर देखिए, वे रिप्रेजेंट कर रहे थे विश्व हिंदू परिषद को.
हाँ, तो एक तो आश्चर्य की बात यह है कि विश्व हिंदू परिषद एक रिवर डैम प्रोजेक्ट की जो मीटिंग है उसमें उसकी स्थान कैसा बन गया. लेकिन जो मैं आपसे पूछना चाह रहा हूँ वो ये है कि ये आस्था को पब्लिक डिस्कोर्स में स्थापित करने का जो प्रयास है, एक कोट अनकोट सेक्युलर संविधान के फ्रेमवर्क में, इसको आप कैसे देखते हैं पॉलिटिकल सेंस में? और पॉलिटिक्स से मेरा मतलब ये पार्टीगत पॉलिटिक्स नहीं, लेकिन पॉलिटिक्स से मेरा मतलब है भविष्य में समाज की संरचना को, क्योंकि आस्था को हमने प्राइवेट मैटर मान के अपने घर में बंद किया हुआ है. पब्लिक में आस्था की बात करना अच्छा नहीं मानते हम लोग आमतौर पर. यहाँ पे प्रोफेसर जी डी अग्रवाल पढ़े लिखे आदमी, साइंटिफिक बैकग्राउंड के आदमी, आस्था को एक पब्लिक सरकारी मीटिंग में प्लेस करना चाह रहे हैं. आप इसको कैसे देखते
किया है? करना चाहे नहीं, उन्होंने किया है. Story in the past, right?
उन्होंने आस्था की बात करी, लेकिन ये आस्था को पब्लिक फोरम में अभी एक्सेप्टेंस नहीं मिला ना आधुनिक हिंदुस्तान में. आप और हम घर पे बैठ के बात कर सकते हैं आस्था के बारे में.
नहीं नहीं नहीं, बात ये है कि ये भी हुई है पब्लिक फोरम पे. वो जब आप देखते हैं कि प्रोफेसर जी डी अग्रवाल, उसके बाद स्वामी सानंद की जो चार Pastan to death रहे हैं, तो I said six of them overall. The first four also had a result. So the result is in the form of what we today know of as Bhagirathi eco-sensitive zone, which is declared by the UPA government. And there's a very fine kind of point which then minister later president
मैं यही कह रहा हूँ, eco sensitive zone एक सेक्युलर शब्द है, उसका आस्था नहीं, नहीं, नहीं,
नहीं, नहीं, नहीं, नहीं, नहीं, मुझे मुझे पूरे करने दीजिए।
अच्छा अच्छा,
प्रणब मुखर्जी जो हमारे प्रेसिडेंट भी रहे हैं और भारत रत्न भी दिया गया है, उन्होंने, वे लिखते हैं कि गंगा जी इज वन ऑफ आर मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट सिंबल्स ऑफ इंडियन कल्चर एंड फेथ एंड हिंदू फेथ। दिस इज पार्ट ऑफ द राइट अप वेयर से द इको सेंसिटिव जोन वाज डिक्लेयर्ड। He mentions this. I can possibly send you the reference so that you can put it up for people to read later.
Okay.
The point is that he writes this specific thing and goes on to say that there is no other stretch of Ganga today which is pristine, and we need to keep a pristine flow of Ganga. So we have decided to, one, cancel and destroy a hydroelectric power project which was being made at that time called Lohri Nagpala. Already a few hundreds of crores was spent on it for its construction, but that was stopped. And from Gangotri to Uttarkashi, a stretch of 135 kilometers of Bhagirathi ji shall be declared as Bhagirathi eco-sensitive zone. And the reasons given for that is actually based on the importance of Bhagirathi, Gangaji in Hindu faith and Indian and Bharatiya Sanskriti. So this was something which is a government document which actually specifies it. So that way, the conscious way in which Professor G.D. Agarwal put forth his argument could not have been completely set aside also. And it found its due place. So Bhagirathi eco-sensitive zone is still existent. And but of course, I do hear voices that say that the current government is interested to try to tamper that status also. Mm. But we'll have to, these are instances where we have to believe that, say, Ma Ganga, wherever she is, she knows what also she has to do. Mm. So that's a separate point. But the key point is that when you mention, say, the question on secularity and the public-private separation that has come about, See, you would have probably noticed in the US elections, the way in which in God we trust becomes a very key aspect that if and when, say, people say that Joe Biden is the president-elect and he starts with a specific quote from the Bible. When he tweets after he is declared by some TV channels as the president-elect, he says that something from Bible and says that this is the time for people to come together, setting aside and we are to be one, and a message from Bible. Look at, say, Republican Party. Republicans are devout Christians in whatever ways they go about. You find their references to Bible. Sometimes I find, say, you can actually learn Christianity in practice by noticing some of these efforts that people do. What they quote from Psalms, Book of Psalms, or Book of John, and so on. And then say, that is what is driving me to do this task. So the kind of impact that the secular action has from the source, which is divine, is something that is very consciously found people expressing. And I don't know whether you call, say, United States of America secular.
Yeah, yeah.
So you do call it secular?
Yes.
Then within the secular, state of United States of America, we do have, say, these expressions which are in the public space. See, it is the Nehruvian imagination of secularity, which was conscious of not to make any of these points of overt or covert display of religiosity as something which is not to be in public space. So this was something which has a peculiarity that you find. But then you do also notice that, say, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru's daughter conducted several havans, and that too in public. Hmm. So I don't know whether you would call it, say, making religion public or not. So why just Srimati Indira Gandhi? It is also the case that Srimati Sonia Gandhi, I have seen, say, before Amethi election or something, where there are photos of her performing a havan and so on. So I do not know if, say, the popular kind of a discourse that says that you keep the pujas and so on private is actually true. Because I come from, say, Hyderabad now, and our chief minister spends about a few tens of crores on conducting Chandi Yaga, Satasahastra Chandi Yaga. And you find, say, he conducts it in a very large, grand scale events also. Hmm. And I don't know if you've heard of this, just before elections, Devegowda goes to Sringeri and along with his son, gets to perform a specific ritual. I forget what Homa they did. And you find that in spite of the fact that Devegowda's party, Janata Dal Secular, ends up with the least number of seats, still the chief minister happens to be Sri H.T. Kumaraswamy. So if at all you look at the Bharatiya Manasikta, you say that that is the effect of that Homa, which was performed in Sringeri. So, see, Indians are religious, and that cannot be removed from our, say, being. There was a wave of atheism, which is true. If you recall, say, in Varanasi, I recall this fine conversation between Rabindranath Tagore and Romarola in 1921 in Geneva. So both were Nobel laureates by then, and Romarola was a great fanboy of India. Mm. And as you know, he also wrote a biography of Mahatma Gandhi and introduced Mahatma Gandhi as the Christ of current times. So he told Europeans that if you want to see Christ in flesh and blood, go, he's there on the banks of Sabarmati.
Achha.
That created a kind of a great kind of fervor in favor of Mahatma Gandhi amongst the European Christians. And such a kind of force cannot be set aside even by the British Empire. Mm. So there's a great degree of this connect that also requires to be seen. But the point that I wanted to bring out is Romarola is very fond of India, and Romarola was going on singing paeans of Indians and their tolerance in front of Rabindranath Tagore. Mm. And Rabindranath Tagore was shaking his head, singing of these paeans about Indians' tolerance. He said, see, Indians' tolerance has now become too extreme, so much so that anything goes. Mm. So if somebody says something, the most stupidest thing also, shayad ye bhi ho sakta hai. Mm. People have actually become so docile, so accepting of any particular thing in spite of... So there's no criticality in terms of trying to measure what is appropriate and what not. So such a kind of, say, state of affairs is not good for any country. And he said that Indians should build a healthy bit of intolerance. And he went on to say, see, I wouldn't mind, I don't know if these are the exact words, but he goes on to say, I probably share that excerpt also. So he says that even if there is a wave of atheism onto India, I think it may do a good to Indians. Because I know that India is deeply religious, and current sense of uncritical acceptance of anything that is happening, that will actually be set right. So India would again move back to a state of composure where there is healthy religious practice with due kind of critical nature that is required to know what is proper religion and what is not. So this kind of a balancing is what you notice Rabindranath Tagore spoke of. And having heard all these requirements, Romarola thoughtfully responded. He said, possibly India requires a dose of scientific nationalism. It's a very, very prescient kind of formulation. So today, if you ask me, what was Pandit Nehru an epitome of? Whatever it is, it would certainly be a scientific nationalism, where scientific should mean that it has a great quotient of atheistic socialism. So the manner in which, say, Indians and the Nehruvian effort to try and, say, bring in this scientific nationalism is possibly a part of, say, what is required for the times of the of those kinds. And today, you have our Prime Minister who goes and makes a very public expression of whatever is his religious belief. You have a Prime Minister who goes right after, say, swearing in, having won the election, goes to Kashi, and then there's a live telecast of the way in which he would do Abhisheka to Shiva in Varanasi, Vishveshwara. So I think, say, our conception of what is the sense of secular is altering very rapidly.
Yes.
And the original sense in which the sense of the term secular was used by Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru also is very insightful. So he, if I'm not wrong, at some point uses, for want of any other words, I'm calling this sense of largeness of heart, not being communal, as being secular.
ठीक है, it's a very काम चलाऊ सा expression, but I mean ठीक है, but I really like कि आपने जिस तरह से नेहरू को रखा एक larger.
I think, say, we need to
परिप्रेक्ष्य में.
Let us actually try and see that we are building on our ancestors, and Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru is certainly one of our ancestors.
Yes, yes.
So we need to know, today when we start looking at what we do, we must see that those kinds of things that Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru missed out on, we need to as well include them and then build on.
So
that is one part. Second part is that what was the mistake that Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru did? So he actually gave a great degree of emphasis on trying to say that everybody has to build a scientific temper. Hmm. Scientific temper is not the be all end all of the very notion of what truth can be, because it's only post 1960 that the West also started doubting whether science has answers to everything.
Yes.
You know, the Club of Rome story, where people started talking about the extinguishing of fossil fuels. So what would be the kind of world that we'd be in, and the climate crisis, which was actually being referred to. All these happened in the 1960s, 70s, by which time, say, Pandit Nehru was not alive. Maybe if he was alive and he got to see this, maybe he would have probably thought that, say, Mahatma Gandhi was always right. I still remember reading his autobiography, where he says, I was never as confident as Mahatma Gandhi was. So I always had this lingering doubt in me. But more often than not, Gandhiji was right. You see, 1908, Hind Swaraj has very radical formulation to speak of the way in which civilization is evil and so on. And that was very emphatically made, so much so that it also says that we know in our own tradition that good spreads very slowly. It's only evil that has great wheels. So railways is evil because it actually quickens the kind of pace of life. This is a logic which is not normal logic. This is not, say, it's a Puranic logic.
Yes.
So this is not the scientific rationality that can actually be pointed out and so on. So in our public discourse, there are several such instances that are still present, even during the Nehruvian times, that were actually very alive. So I don't think, say, Indian public space can be slotted to be this, but Indian bureaucracy is like that. The bureaucrats are the ones who are actually stuck because of their Macaulay education, which alienates them from actually wanting to combine the public and private spheres. Now, of course, we are in a very new state. A person who is just woken up might as well say, I just woke up. I'm brushing my teeth on Twitter or Facebook. So where exactly is private today? You have photographs of the bedrooms which are actually put up on Instagram. What is private? I don't know. See, our conception of public and private also has, say, now undergone drastic shift. So if we open up on this, then say there are so many things that we say. So to my understanding, if at all people give an answer that this is secular space, so this argument does not hold, it only means that they are actually in some time warp. They are not actually keeping pace with times. And any argument, when it is presented, it has to be dealt with on merits. It's only a person who is not capable of dealing with it on merits who is the one who would actually try to slight it or deflect it.
Yes, yes.
So that way, the effort made by Professor G.D. Agarwal to make a scientific case for whether or not to go ahead with Tehri Dam construction was never actually taken up in post-independent India, and that too under that government, which claimed itself to be very strongly faithful to Indian culture, because it was the first National Democratic Alliance government under Prime Minister Sri Atal Bihari Vajpayee. And as you know, Sri Murali Manohar Joshi ji was somebody who was very fond of Indian culture and so on. And he's a great scholar on all these aspects. In spite of he being the chairperson, the thing did not go through. So either you say that they were all people who meant well, but then the force of the times and the kind of, say, place that you are present in cannot but let you go ahead with the flow of the time, and you do not have the strength to oppose it. Either you say it, or you say that they are people who were hypocritical. I would prefer, say, the first explanation, because it is indeed true that the times we live in are such that there are forces which are greatly invisible, which require to be fought before, say, a political leader, the Prime Minister, who can as well go ahead and say that this is what is in line with our cultural heritage, and we go ahead with this come what may. To be in a position to say that, the kind of force that is required in the society, in the world, as on today, is non-existent.
नहीं ठीक है, फेयर इनफ. और मुझे लगता है ये इम्पोर्टेंट बात है कि बहुत आसान होगा हम जैसों के लिए किसी को हिपोक्रेट कह के डिसमिस कर देना, लेकिन जिस समय में हम जी रहे हैं, जिस माहौल में हम जी रहे हैं, जिस बहाव में हम जी रहे हैं, उस बहाव का अपना एक मोमेंटम है, उस बहाव का अपना एक फोर्स है. और जैसे कि आपने कहा, मुरली मनोहर जोशी जैसा विद्वान आदमी जो कल्चरली रूटेड भी है, वो भी शायद अपने आप को असहाय महसूस किया होगा. हालांकि वो भी शायद,
I mean, whether he felt or not, we need to give that
benefit of doubt. देना ही चाहिए, बिल्कुल सही बात.
So that is the standpoint that I see. We need to see this entire thing.
Fair enough. ठीक है, अब हमको एक्चुअली डेढ़ घंटा हो गया है और हमको अगले आधे घंटे में ये रैप अप करना चाहिए. इसमें एक महत्वपूर्ण सवाल जो मैं आपसे उठाना चाह रहा हूँ, थोड़ा सा गंगा से अलग हटके ये सवाल है, लेकिन पिछले आपकी पिछले जो रिकॉर्डिंग थी,
एक मिनट में भूलने से पहले आपको कह देना चाहता हूँ कि पिछली बार जब मैं कह रहा था कि जिस चीफ इंजीनियर को पद्मश्री दिया गया है, उनका नाम था श्री सुमंत किशोर जैन.
अच्छा,
तो ये नाम मुझे तब याद नहीं आया, पर बाद में देखा तो ये आ गया. तो हाँ, ये भी शायद आप मेंशन कर सकते हैं.
आप रिहंड डैम के संदर्भ में कह रहे हैं, रिहंड डैम इंजीनियर थे वो, श्री
जिनको पद्मश्री दिया गया,
उनको पद्मश्री दिया गया. और वो जो कहानी थी कि वो प्रोफेसर
जीडी अग्रवाल
को और बाद में सारा क्रेडिट उनको देते हैं एक प्राइवेट पब्लिक मीटिंग. हाँ ठीक है, ठीक है. तो
आप कुछ पूछ रहे थे.
हाँ, तो अगले आधे घंटे में इसको रैप अप करते हैं। उसमें एक महत्वपूर्ण सवाल जो आपसे पूछना चाह रहा हूँ, आपकी पिछले रिकॉर्डिंग में आया था ये, जो भारत का जो संविधान है जो कि हस्तलिखित है, प्रिंटेड नहीं है, जो ओरिजिनली हाथ से लिखा गया संविधान है, आपने उसमें हमारा ध्यान दिलाया कि उसमें बहुत सारे इलस्ट्रेशंस हैं, बल्कि मैं समझता हूँ 22 इलस्ट्रेशंस हैं। तो हर चैप्टर के शुरू में एक इलस्ट्रेशन है, जैसे उसमें राम का एक चित्र है, कृष्ण का एक चित्र है, भगवान बुद्ध का चित्र, ऐसे बहुत सारे चित्र हैं। और जैसे आपने कहा कि जो 13वां अध्याय है उसके शुरू में जो चित्र है वो है भगीरथ तपस्या कर रहे हैं और तपस्या करके गंगा को धरती पर ला रहे हैं। अब इसमें शायद ये इस बात पे हमको थोड़ी बात करनी चाहिए कि पॉपुलर मेमोरी में या पॉपुलर इम्प्रेशन जो है संविधान का, वो केवल और केवल एक टेक्सचुअल बुक, एक टेक्सचुअल डॉक्यूमेंट के रूप में है। ये चित्र हमारे पॉपुलर इमेजिनेशन में है नहीं संविधान के बारे में। और आपने ये थोड़ा सा इस बात पे हिंट करते हुए कहा था कि नवज्योति सर कहा करते थे कि जिस माहौल में हमको आज़ादी मिली 1947 में, ये एक तरह से उस माहौल का रिफ्लेक्शन है कि हमने और संविधान के जानकारों ने केवल टेक्स्ट पे ही ध्यान दिया है और जो इलस्ट्रेशंस हैं वो हमारे चिंताओं से, हमारे कंसर्न से शायद धूमिल हो गए। थोड़ी बात इस पे रखिए कि ऐसा क्यों हुआ कि इलस्ट्रेशन जो है संविधान में वो हमारे मेमोरी से गायब हो गए, संविधान की जो हमारी जानकारी है उससे गायब हो गए।
आपने प्रोफेसर नवज्योति सिंह जी की जिक्र की, तो उनकी इस विषय पर बहुत ही गहरी सोच रही है। उनका कहना यह है कि विश्व में ऐसा कोई और संविधान नहीं है जिसमें आपको ऐसे चित्र दिखाई दे। पहली बात, देयर इज पॉसिबली नो अदर कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन ऑफ द वर्ल्ड दैट हैज सच काइंड ऑफ इलस्ट्रेशंस टू गो विद इट। एंड इज इट द केस दैट दीज इलस्ट्रेशंस आर जस्ट डेकोरेटिव एलिमेंट्स फॉर द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन? That is one question that necessarily has to be kept in mind. And thankfully, there is a judgment of Allahabad High Court, Lucknow bench, delivered on the 1st of January 1993 in a very unique case where in Ayodhya, there was the Ram Lalla, the Virajman, whose Puja was not happening, and there was a this was post the Babri Masjid. In those days, it also was a disputed structure. So the collapse of the disputed structure, Babri Masjid, resulted in a situation where the Ram Lalla Virajman was not having any puja. So there was a request put in by Vishwa Hindu Adhivakta Sangh for requesting permission to do puja to Ram Lalla Virajman. So the judge concerned, so it was the Harinath Tilhari ji. So Professor Navjyoti and I went and met him in Lucknow to actually discuss on this particular judgment that was delivered. So he was the one who had a copy of one of the early copies of calligraphic edition of the Constitution of India. And the copy that he had was actually given to him by a journalist whose cases he used to handle earlier as a lawyer. and he was to give him some money. And then, if I'm not wrong, his name was Sri Iqbal Siddiqui. So this gentleman, he received a copy of the Constitution from Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, and it was a calligraphic edition. When this calligraphic edition had these illustrations. So if you go to Parliament Library, you can still see the original one which is still preserved with all kinds of chemicals to ensure that it doesn't get damaged and so on, which has these signatures and so on. This was a photolithographed copy of the same. So that copy was there with Justice Harinath Tilhari ji of Allahabad High Court, Lucknow bench. So he was given by Iqbal Siddiqui ji, saying that मैं आपको पैसे नहीं दे सकता, पर शायद ये देख सकता हूँ आपको कुछ काम आ जाए, आप अयोध्या केस पे बैठे हुए हैं. तो इन दैट ही सॉ दैट इन द फंडामेंटल राइट्स चैप्टर पेज देयर आर दिस देयर इज एन इलस्ट्रेशन व्हिच हैज रामा लक्ष्मण एंड सीता इन द पुष्पक विमान एंड द डिस्क्रिप्शन राइट्स they are returning to Ayodhya having defeated Ravana in Lanka. So such was the kind of description which is there for this illustration, and it is part of the epic period. So the periodization is epic period. So this is a in history you have this formulation that in discovery of India and whatever are the historians which base themselves on discovery of India kind of mold, you have the Indus Valley civilization or the Harappan civilization, followed by you have Vedic period, and Vedic period followed by epic period, and then epic period Ramayana times, Mahabharata times, and then you have Mahajanapada period, and followed by Mauryan empire and so on. So this is a kind of periodization. Today, of course, that periodization is no longer accepted, and there are a lot of challenges posed and so on, and there are these questions which are still open. But key point is that this justice noticed this, and he stated in his judgment, giving permission for Vishwa Hindu Adhivakta Sangh to perform puja at the at that location where Sri Ramlala Virajman was seated, so that puja could go on. And because he said that Rama is not just a mythical being or a itihasa purusha in Ramayana, but he is actually a constitutional being, because his illustration is there, his reference is there, and like it is the case that every constitutional entity is to be protected by the state of India, Rama being a constitutional being ought also to be protected by the state of India. So such was the kind of point that he makes, and he made a list of all that, saying that the original constitution, which was signed by the Constituent Assembly members, had these illustrations. So they were aware of these illustrations, and they endorsed these illustrations. And he went on to write that Indian secularism is actually defined by these illustrations.
Very important.
I can possibly share that judgment also with you, and yes, the relevant paragraphs for the same. So he mentioned that so he actually says Indian secularism is to be defined by these, by the presence of these illustrations. So that is what the judgment said, and that means that, say, it is now part of the case law. So there was a challenge to this judgment, but then the Supreme Court did not entertain that, which means that, say, it still stands as a part of the case law and valid part of law in the Indian law. That's one side of the story. So Professor Navjyoti was conscious of this, but ही इज नॉट लाइक द जस्टिस हूज कंसर्न वाज रादर लिमिटेड. So Navjyoti actually imagined it in the sense of what does it mean to have illustrations in a text which is meant to have only the text of the constitution. So such was the question that he posed, and he then went on to say that no other constitution actually defines a nation, because it may speak of the state of each of these. So you have this notion of nation state and nation state present. So the formulation of what is Indian nation is actually expressed by these illustrations, and this is probably the most unique aspect of what Indian constitution is. So this was a point that Professor Navjyoti emphatically made.
Yes.
And he actually brought this out by pointing to the very idea of constitution in the Greek sense. Mm-hmm. So he goes to the theories, the foundational theories of constitution, and points out that in Greece, you had these gymnasiums where several people assembled there, and each one was actually training to become the best in their respective sports. So the nation of people who actually have best exemplars is what is the manner in which the constitution of the Greek nation was imagined, is how he actually points out by referring to these Greek gymnasiums. And that's a fascinating kind of intervention into what is the constitutional theories that are existent in the world as on today. So actually the third workshop that he intended to do was on society and polity. And if you recall, his desire was that it must be done not in a democratic country. He wanted to do it in a monarchy, which of course now probably even Bhutan is moving towards a democracy. But he desired that, say, this happen in Bhutan, because there you can actually do a proper kind of observation of what is happening in the name of democracy as well. So that was something that his passing away did cause a great dent. But that means that, say, his students like you and I have an obligation to keep that alive. That is one part. But the second point is that Professor Navjyoti also pointed out that Indian nation and the India's independence came also with partitioning of India. That was a tragic story. It's not something that one can as well be, you cannot think of 15th of August 1947 without also recognizing that it was also the day of the partitioning of India, partitioning of undivided India.
Yes.
And that it's not just a point of, say, a matter of partitioning alone, but it actually is a wound which is still so alive in our hearts.
Yes.
I do not think that, say, that is a wound which is healed as yet. In yes. spite of many efforts that many people would like to say that the formulation of this separation is good for Indians, because you are able to as well be the way in which you would like, but
the wound is wound there, is something.
Certainly. And the wound also has a great degree of impact. And it has an impact in Adhidaivata plane also. So that maybe, say, when we discuss those deep Adhibhuta, Adhidaiva, Adhyatma, we can discuss it in detail. Now, point is that what was the celebration that Indians have had having gotten their independence? This is a question that Professor Navjyoti posed. See, normally, In our history, you would see that when a king actually won an empire, there used to be a celebration, and you have these several Vijaya Stambhas, victory pillars, that used to be erected. And what exactly can you claim as a kind of monument that Indians built post-independence? where exactly is the monument that you can say is actually the sign of India getting its independence? This was a question that he posed. And maybe one could say that the reconstruction of Somnath Temple is one such, but then it was not done by the state of India. It was done by the private people who are also probably part of the state of India. So it is true that, say, the president of India goes and installs the Somnath Shivalinga, Jyotirlinga, but then it is not something that is a state celebration. One could as well say that in the post-World War era, Indians were poor, so we could not think of a monument, etc. But that is actually poor imagination. If at all you are planning for a monument for that and you want to celebrate it, it would actually generate a lot of jobs, much more jobs than, say, you could imagine, if at all you imagine in a grand manner. Because in earlier times, say, Brihadeeswaralaya that was built in Tanjavur, that's a construction activity which went on for some decades. And that would mean that, say, so many people are also employed for that task. But then our state of affairs was possibly not even in that direction. And there's a tragedy that also got just after a few months of India's independence, Mahatma Gandhi was assassinated. And in that sense, now here was something where Professor Navjyoti makes a very fine kind of imaginative intervention. He says that this is exactly what might have happened. His point was, when Mahatma Gandhi passed away, that when he was assassinated, became martyr, in the Constituent Assembly, there was a very clear demand. Where exactly are we recalling Mahatma Gandhi? In the text of the Constitution. See, November 4th, 1948, was when the draft constitution was presented to the Constituent Assembly by Dr. Ambedkar. And then there was a great degree of critique of the same, and then, say, there was a revision of the same and so on. Now, the point to be noticed is that 30th January 1948 is Martyrs Day, the day when Mahatma Gandhi was assassinated. And in between, there was actually a gap. So when the draft constitution debates happened, Professor Navjyoti actually stated that there must have been a very strong kind of voice, which was not possibly, say, recorded, but was present, that stated that Mahatma Gandhi must be in some manner present as part of the constitution. See, father of our nation is a kind of a term which is used for Mahatma Gandhi. And there was some few years ago when Shri P. Chidambaram was the Home Minister, there was a sixth class girl who put a Right to Information Act request saying that, is there any existent, say, law or a government order that says that Mahatma Gandhi is the father of our nation? It was this RTA request was put to the Ministry of Home Affairs. And as the Home Minister, P. Chidambaram also made a statement saying that there is no such a thing existent. You see, constitution is something that gave birth to the nation. So if you want to talk of a father of the nation cannot be coming after the birth of the nation, right? Father of the nation precedes the birth of the nation. And if the constitution is what is giving birth to the nation, then within that constitution's copy, you should find the reference to father of the nation. And you do find the reference to Mahatma Gandhi amongst these 22 illustrations, father of our nation mentioned not once, but twice. And Mahatma Gandhi is spoken of thrice in the illustrations. By the way, who was the one who actually called Mahatma Gandhi father of our nation? Quiz question. Quiz question. Harsh, any guesses?
Subhash Bose.
Pretty, very true. So Subhash Chandra Bose, actually, say, there's an illustration of Subhash Chandra Bose with a salute where he says, Mahatma Ji, father of our nation, in this holy war of India's liberation, we seek your blessings. This is actually written in, a, I think, say, 19th illustration or so. And prior to that, the previous illustration is an illustration on Noakhali, where Mahatma Gandhi and Suhrawardi. Suhrawardi is standing behind Mahatma Gandhi, and then say the people who are affected by riots were actually being, say, there was paramarsha going on. So on one side, say, this is the second reference. And the third and the first reference in the sequence is that of 1930, Dandi March.
Dandi March, yes.
So Mahatma Gandhi, Dandi March, and there, father of our nation, Mahatma Gandhi, is the description that is present in the for the illustration within the constitution text. So the point is that these illustrations, one, they define the nation, and they also gave you the father of our nation. You, so if at all, I mean, if I were the teacher of that sixth class girl, I would actually point out to this calligraphic edition and say that, as you see, you cannot talk of your father before you are born. So your father must be older than you. So similarly, father of the nation is prior to, say, the birth of the nation, which means, say, he is present in the constitution. So, and I would have shown that thing. But your question was about why is it that it is not popular?
Yes.
And Professor Navjyoti had an answer. One, because have we actually come to terms with, say, what these illustrations speak of? That's a question. If you actually take a careful look at the Marxist historiography in India, and also about the way in which the Congress governments ruled India, their impression of who is the ideal ruler. But Nehru had an ideal ruler in Ashoka. So Mauryan Ashoka was a ruler whose emulation needs to be done. So the choice of Sarnath capital as one of the key aspects, whether it is of Ashoka or a later one, is a different story. But point is that Sarnath capital is part also because it is the Ashokan pillar. Second point, Ashoka as the referent ruler as to who is the ideal ruler on one side. And the second, who is the referent ruler who must be the inspiration for post-independent India turns out to be Akbar. Both these are actually part of the illustrations. So now you have 22 illustrations, of which Mahatma Gandhi, Akbar, and Ashoka. So weave a kind of imaginative way in which country's rule can happen with these three as the exemplars. What you get is Congress rule. Okay. So now, if at all the BJP government would want to pick, say, Ram,
maybe
Lakshmana and Sita as their, say, referent. Or recently in Karnataka, there have been a lot of hue and cry about the celebration of Tipu Jayanti. Tipu Sultan is also one of the illustrations. So in my understanding, so long as we accept that this is part of the constitution, Tipu Jayanti is acceptable, irrespective of whatever jihad and the kind of atrocities he may have committed on the Malabar coast or on the poor people and so on and so forth. One must embrace this as, say, the present, as present as part of the historical memory, which is present and prevalent. So the other point is that the day we are able to as well have a grand narrative which can actually bring together all these illustrations and say that we embrace all of this past without ever leaving out anything. See, if you ask me, given a choice between embracing all of past or make a selection from the past saying that the others, I don't want to remember, I would always say that that kind of a narrative which can take all of your past forward without actually setting anything aside is a more powerful kind of a idea that we ought to teach our people of India, and also teach ourselves and to our children. So that did not happen as yet, but that is something that can only happen when our commitment to the foundational ground on which this constitution is built, which is Satya, is something that we embrace without any kind of fear or favor. That hasn't yet happened. And that not happening is something that is also making us suffer in many a way. So Professor Navjyoti's response to this inclusion of the illustrations is what is fascinating. He said there was this insistence that Mahatma Gandhi should somehow be inserted. And then say there was a brilliant idea. Let us have an illustration. Now, you can't put only Mahatma Gandhi's illustration. And it sounds absurd in a country where, say, there are so many such great people, and Mahatma Gandhi himself would not like it. Mahatma Gandhi was a Ram Bhakta. Mahatma Gandhi was someone who had great degree of respect for, the Indian past. He strongly felt that, say, we need to learn a lot from the past. And what we are currently having is nowhere close to what we had in the past. So such a kind of person, if you are to as well say illustrate. Then came also Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru's discovery of India, which gave, say, the other kind of possibilities that are there. And all this has to be put together. So it was put together in Shantiniketan under the illustrious leadership of Sri Nandalal Bose, who was also instrumental in actually depicting what is the Indian life in that Haripura session.
Yes.
Of Indian National Congress. So these are all, say, the points that come in. And my learning has actually pointed out that, say, this imagination, while quite true, you may not possibly be, finding this reference easily. But there is one reference where, say, a question is asked about Mahatma Gandhi just before the Constituent Assembly was being signed. So that reference, and then there was this, there's now letters available that actually tell you when was it that this illustration exercise happened. So I happened to meet the relative of Sri Prem Bihari Narayan Raizada, who was the one who did the calligraphy free of cost, because he felt that this is a contribution of love. His name is Prem Bihari Narayan Raizada. So if you look at the Constitution of India's preamble, which is very beautifully illustrated, on top of the Constitution of India, you have a calligraphic Prem written on it.
So
you need to carefully observe to actually find Prem in it.
So,
it's not just Satya, Satyameva Jayate, that is actually there. You have anglicized P-R-E-M. Before, say, the preamble can be read in the Constitution. So think of, say, Prem and Satya as the base of the Constitution, which is not what you get taught anywhere. But I do foresee a future where, say, we'll be doing that. And then we'll actually embrace all our past without any kind of fear or favor. And we know where to place which past in what manner, because we are confident of thinking about how we intend to conduct ourselves. So till that kind of a confidence comes about, we'd actually be dilly-dallying. Well, we can't do this, we can't do that, and so on. Swami Sanand was somebody who definitely gave a concrete possibility where that could have actually become reality. If at all his point on Gangaji was taken strongly. Because the 13th illustration is the Ganga Avatarana. And you see, these things are like this, that if you actually stick on to one thing, the rationality and the force of rationality that comes with it would force you to actually put all these things together. Dharma is such that, you see, there's this famous quote which from Bhagavad Gita that even Sri Aurobindo says, Svalpam apyasya dharmasya rayate mahato bhayat. So dharma, even when performed in its its minutest form, it can actually increase your strength to perform greater dharma. and gradually say whatever is a great fear that you may have on account of not following dharma, it is driven away.
ठीक है प्रणव, मुझे लगता है संविधान के ऊपर इस तरह की चर्चा बहुत वैल्यूएबल चर्चा है और इसमें आपका धन्यवाद और हमारे टीचर ज्योति सर का
lot more to say discuss on this.
वो करेंगे, लेकिन मुझे लगा कि ये वैल्यूएबल है कि हमने प्रोफेसर जीडी अग्रवाल का जो तपस्या थी उसको हमने एक लार्जर डेवलपमेंटल डिबेट से भी जोड़ा और जो हमारा जो संविधान है उससे भी जोड़ा और जो हमारी जो कल्चरल कॉन्शियसनेस का जो क्राइसिस है उससे भी जोड़ा और इस और कॉन्शियंस और ये एक व्यापक तस्वीर पेश करता है प्रोफेसर जी डी अग्रवाल स्वामी सानंद की. वो केवल एक एनवायरमेंटलिस्ट के दृष्टि से देखेंगे तो काफ़ी कुछ इसमें से मिस हो जाएगा. अब हमको 2 घंटे हो गए हैं, मैं एक बहुत तुरंत छोटा सा सवाल पूछूंगा, उसका बहुत ही छोटा सा दीजिएगा ताकि फिर इसको हम रैप अप कर सकें. कुछ रीडिंग मटेरियल आप सजेस्ट करना चाहेंगे क्या मेरे लिए या हमारे मित्रों के लिए, जो ना केवल प्रोफेसर जी डी अग्रवाल के बारे में थोड़ा सा और बताएगा लेकिन जो उनके कंसर्न्स थे उसको थोड़ा सा और एड्रेस करता हो.
तो एक तो बात यह है कि डॉक्टर संदीप पांडे ने एक पुस्तक की कंपाइलेशन की है ऑन द फास्टिंग सेंस ऑफ फॉर गंगा. दिस इज करंटली पुट अप ऑन archive.org, सो आई कैन सेंड दैट लिंक टू यू.
ओके.
एंड फ्रॉम अमंग्स द वेरियस बुक्स दैट स्वामी सानंद स्पोक ऑफ, ही वाज वेरी फॉन्ड ऑफ दिस बुक. इट्स कॉल्ड सामर्थ्य और सीमा बाय भगवती चरण वर्मा. So if we get to talk further on this topic, and because we haven't actually come to Swami Sanand's actual fast and the kind of political ramifications and the issues that were raised and what are the state that we are in and the kind of variety of dimensions that his fast in the end has opened up. So those are all questions which are yet to be discussed. So if we do get time to discuss those in future, then in that context, I'll also tell you what Samarthya or Seema and the manner in which Swami Sanand put it. He always used to say that we require people who have Samarthya or Samarpan Bhava, jo apne Seema ko bhi jane. For people to accomplish things, these are requirements. So,
दोबारा दिखाइए क्या सामर्थ्य और सीमा. ये
सामर्थ्य और सीमा, सो दिस इज एक्चुअली अ बुक रिटन बाय श्री भगवती चरण वर्मा.
हां,
वाज अ फॉर्मर राज्यसभा एमपी, अ क्लोज फ्रेंड ऑफ पंडित जवाहरलाल नेहरू. एंड पंडित जवाहरलाल नेहरू, व्हाइल ही वाज गोइंग अबाउट टेलिंग पीपल दैट डैम्स आर द न्यू टेंपल्स ऑफ इंडिया, हियर इज अ बुक रिटन बाय हिज क्लोज फ्रेंड एंड अ ग्रेट थिंकर हु एक्चुअली पॉइंट्स आउट व्हाट इज द फ्लॉ इन दैट.
Huh.
Saying that there is a limit to human endeavor. Engineering cannot actually do that. And this story actually tells you the story of a particular princely state where a dam construction is planned and that results in a huge deluge, completely, say, submerging the entire princely state. A very fascinating account. And this was actually written in the 1960s. When Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru was alive.
ठीक है, बढ़िया. ठीक है प्रणव, तो हम अपने इस वार्तालाप को यहाँ पे विराम देते हैं.
ठीक है,
आपका धन्यवाद.
बहुत खुशी हुई ये सब हुआ.
हाँ, और आगे अपनी बातें और आगे बढ़ाएंगे, फिर अगली रिकॉर्डिंग फिर से प्लान करते हैं, देखते हैं कब होती है. लेकिन
मेरे
ख्याल से ये जो 2 रिकॉर्डिंग्स हुई है प्रोफेसर जी डी अग्रवाल के ऊपर, मुझे तो इसमें काफी वैल्यूएबल लगा है, काफी काफी कुछ सोचने विचारने का मटेरियल मिला है और इसके लिए आपका धन्यवाद.
आपको धन्यवाद ताकि आप इस पर एक काइंड ऑफ प्लेटफॉर्म दे रहे हैं ताकि इन सब पर चर्चा हो सके.
हाँ, मेरे ख्याल से होनी भी चाहिए, ऐसी और भी चर्चाएं होनी चाहिए. ठीक है, तो इस रिकॉर्डिंग में को मैं यहाँ रोक दे रहा हूँ. आप ठीक है, नमस्ते.